Okay. Tonight is called the Chula Vidala Sutta, the shorter series of questions and answers. Almost always, when the sutta says it's a shorter, it's longer. I haven't figured that out yet. But thus have I heard on one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Rajagaha in the bamboo grove, the squirrel sanctuary. Could you imagine sitting in a squirrel sanctuary, sitting in meditation? Those guys would climb all over. Then the lay follower Visakha went to the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina after paying homage to her, sat down at one side and asked her a question. Visakha was married to Dhammadina. Okay, they were husband and wife. And he was a very well-off merchant of some sort. But he spent a lot of time going to where the Buddha was and practicing meditation. And one day he came home, and Visakha would always meet him at the gate, and they would hug and walk together into the house. And this day he stopped her from doing that. And she thought, he must not be happy with me for some reason or other. And they went into the house, and he ate his meal, and he decided he was just going to lay down and take some rest. So he laid down on the bed, and she laid down on the bed beside him. And he got up and laid down on the floor. She got up and laid down on the floor. And he got up and laid down on the bed. And she thought, well, he must really be mad at me for acting this way, so I gotta find out what's the problem. And she started asking him what the problem was. And finally he said, you know, I've been going and spending time with the Buddha, and I've been doing a lot of meditation, and I have become an anagami. And that means no more sexual activity. That we can live like brother and sister, but that's as close as we can come, and we can't sleep in the same bed anymore. So he said, if you want to get a divorce, you can get a divorce. If you want to stay here, I'll leave and go someplace else. Anything you want, we can do it that way. And she had been very interested in the Buddha's teaching for a number of years. And she asked him if she could become a bhikkhuni. And he said, well, of course you can. So she left and she became a bhikkhuni. And after 2 or 3 months, she became an arahat. And she was very well known for her. She was like the Sariputta of the women. Sariputta was second to the Buddha in wisdom. And she was the female followers, the bhikkhuni. She was second to the Buddha in wisdom for the females. So she was quite an interesting person. And Visakha would go and visit her and ask questions. And that's what this sutta is all about. Okay, lady, identity. Identity is said. What is called identity by the Blessed One? Friend Visakha, these five aggregates affected by craving and clinging are called identity by the Blessed One. That is the material form aggregate affected by craving and clinging. The feeling aggregate affected by craving and clinging. The perception aggregate affected by craving and clinging. The formation aggregate affected by craving and clinging. The consciousness aggregate affected by craving and clinging. These five aggregates affected by craving and clinging are called identity by the Blessed One. Now, they're called identity by the Blessed One because of the craving and clinging. An arahat still has five aggregates, but it's not affected by craving and clinging anymore. So, that's just to clear up some of the thinking about arahats and whether they think or not. Yes, they think. But they aren't affected by craving or clinging anymore. Their mind is very pure. It's like I tell you to ask your intuition about certain things. Okay, ask your intuition how you can overcome this problem. Well, they're into their intuition all the time. So it's real nice being around them because they're going to give you the straight answers. Saying, good lady, the lay follower Visakha delighted and rejoiced in the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina's words. Then he asked her a further question. Lady, origin of identity is said. What is called the origin of identity by the Blessed One? Friend Visakha, it is craving, which brings renewal of being, is accompanied by delight and lust, and delights in this and that. That is craving for sensual pleasures, craving for habitual tendencies, and craving for non-being. This is called the origin of identity by the Blessed One. Lady, cessation of identity is said. What is called the cessation of identity by the Blessed One? Friend Visakha, it is the remainderless fading away and cessation, the giving up, relinquishing, letting go, relaxing, and rejecting of that same craving. That is called the cessation of identity by the Blessed One. So it's not nothing. When you become an arahat, I hope all of you do, you still have thoughts. And you're not identifying with craving. You don't have any craving come up in your mind anymore. But you're still a human being. There is a story about this one monk. He was very short. He was like 3 feet tall. But he was an arahat. And after a while, somebody went to the Buddha and said, what did he do in the past to make himself such a small little guy? And the Buddha said, well, He was the head of a committee that was building a spiritual monument, like a church. And they all wanted to make a big one, and he kept on saying, no, let's make it small. So that's why he's only 3 feet tall. Be careful
what you wish for.
Okay. Lady, the way leading to the cessation of identity, the way leading to the cessation of identity. What is called the way leading to the cessation of identity by the Blessed One? So if you haven't noticed, what we've been talking about all the way is the Four Noble Truths, all the way through. Friend Visakha, it is just this Noble Eightfold Path. Now, I don't like the way the Eightfold Path is presented, because they always write this and write that. And if there's write this and write that, then there's wrong this and wrong that. And it kind of paints the world into a black and white idea. So I started changing some words around, and I started calling it harmonious instead of right. Okay. Now, the first the way that they put it in the sutta here, they call it right view, and I call it harmonious perspective. What is a harmonious perspective? It's seeing things without any craving in your mind. It's seeing things as being completely impersonal. And that's the harmonious perspective. There was somebody that asked one of my teachers, why did the Buddha start out with right view? And this is probably the most important part of the Eightfold Path, is the harmonious perspective of seeing everything as part of an impersonal process. Because the more you see everything as an impersonal process, the less attached you become to it, the less you try to control things. And you start to understand everything as part of a process instead of a personal thing to control. And this is real important. This is a real important perspective to carry with you as much as you can. Now, the next fold of the Eightfold Path, Bhikkhu Bodhi calls it right intention, and I really don't agree with that very much at all. Before this edition, in his other edition, he had right thought. And I don't much agree with that either. But when he changed it to intention, that changes a lot of the understanding of the Eightfold Path. Because intention has, I am there. It's my intention. So I call this the harmonious imaging. always smiling, or I'm always poor, or I never smile, I'm always angry. What kind of an image do you hold about yourself? I hold an image of myself as being prosperous, and I am, very. Doesn't necessarily mean anything to do with material things, but I have friends all over the world, and they like me enough that they ask me to come see them. So I get to travel all over the world, and that's one of the things I really like. It's because I hold that image in my mind. When I think about myself, I think of myself as being prosperous. I have a friend that they continually hold the image of being poor. And as a result, they're always poor. What kind of an image do you hold about yourself? Imaging means the way you picture yourself. How do you picture yourself? Do you picture yourself as intelligent? Do you picture yourself as being dumb? Well, how do you picture yourself? Oh, I'm always this way. Well, you hold that image and you're going to be that way. I always am hard on myself. Well, as a result, guess what? You're going to be hard on yourself. One of the things that I'm trying to show you with this retreat is to change your image so you see yourself as smiling and happy and generous and helpful to other people. It takes a period of time to be able to hold that image before it actually starts to happen. You can't hold any negative images about yourself while you're doing it. I'm a monk. I don't have any money, but I'm building a meditation center. And it's worth right now probably somewhere around $750,000. And I don't have any money. One of the things that you need to realize is as you keep your precepts and hold the image of always keeping your precepts without breaking them, when you take care of Dhamma in this way, Dhamma will take care of you. And you're always going to have what you need. Don't always necessarily get what you want, but you always get what you need. So the more you hold that image of being prosperous, being helpful, being kind, being intelligent, being helpful, whatever image you hold about yourself, that's what you're going to become. And that's real important to understand. This harmonious imaging does work. I never hold an image of myself as being famous. I don't even know what famous means. I've been told that I am, but that doesn't mean anything to me. I don't care about being famous. I care about the Dhamma. I hold the image of myself being able to teach the Dhamma. And where my highest happiness is. So whatever image you hold for yourself, stay with it, and it will begin to occur for you as you keep your precepts without breaking. Now the next fold of the Eightfold Path, they call it right speech, and I really find that as it's kind of confusing, because speech to everyone means what you say to somebody else. And who do you talk to more than anybody else? Yourself. So you want to have harmonious speech. You want to be kind to yourself. Be gentle with yourself. If you're critical of yourself, you're going to wind up with all kinds of problems. So, the kinder you are to yourself, the better your speech is to yourself, the better your speech is to other people. It works that way. So the more harmonious your speech can become to yourself, and the kinder you are to yourself. You've heard me talk a lot about gratitude on this retreat. Why do you think I mentioned that? Be grateful for what's happening in your mind. The more grateful you are, the better your speech becomes. The kinder you become not only to yourself, but to other people too. So, harmonious communication is really necessary for your well-being. One of the things that when I started with Mahasi Sayadaw, they started talking about the Eightfold Path. And then they said, you know, right speech and right action and right livelihood, that's only part of morality. You don't have to pay attention to that. If you're sitting in meditation, you're practicing it. So they effectively took the Eightfold Path and turned it into a Fivefold Path. And then they changed samadhi to mean moment-to-moment awareness, which it never has meant. So they took and changed that and changed it to a fourfold path. Now there's, for the last 2,300 years, 2,400 years or so, there's always been an argument between practicing monks and scholar monks about the Eightfold Path, because the scholar monks say, well, the right speech, right action, right livelihood, that's only morality, you don't have to pay attention to that so much. But, you know, as I was starting to study more and more about the Buddha and his teachings, I ran across in the Vinaya the story of the Buddha and how he was teaching the monks when he first started the wheel of the spinning of the wheel of Dhamma. And he talked about the Eightfold Path in his first talk. And he was talking to monks that were really pretty good monks. They weren't They got kind of disillusioned by him because he was starving himself, and then he started, well, this way doesn't work, so I'm going to try something else, and I'm so weak I have to build up my strength. So he started eating, and he started gaining some strength back, and they thought he'd given up the spiritual path and left. So they got kind of disillusioned with him. But when he came and he started talking to them and talking about the Eightfold Path, he didn't just divide these three little things and say, well, that's only morality. No, that was part of the practice. So the right speech, the harmonious communication, is the communication you're using with yourself and how you think about other people, and have that communication uplifted. Now, the next fold of the Eightfold Path, we call it right action. And basically, they mean it's basically keeping the precepts, following those kind of action. But I call this harmonious movement. I call it harmonious movement because we have a tendency when things don't quite go the way we want while we're sitting, we have a tendency to kind of jerk our mind around and try to force things to be the way we want them to be, and we give ourselves headaches and we cause ourselves all kinds of problems. So I call this harmonious movement, being gentle with the movements of mind's attention. Don't be harsh. Don't be pushy. Don't try to force things to be the way you want them to be. Softly. How many have you heard me say something like that? Gently? Have you heard that maybe? Be nice to yourself. Just because your mind takes off on some kind of wild tangent, so what? It's all right. What are you going to do with it? You going to fight with it? You going to push it around and try to force your mind to, you stay here, whether I like it or you want to or not. I want you to be here. It's never going to do that. It's always going to be out running around and doing all kinds of weird things. So, gentle movements, kind movements in yourself, and keeping your precepts. Now, the next fold of the Eightfold Path, they call it right livelihood. I always get a kick out of the definition of right livelihood. Well, don't sell any weapons. Don't sell any poisons. But what does that have to do with these monks that were, they were nice guys. They didn't mess around with that kind of stuff. What's right livelihood? I call it harmonious lifestyle. And you have to be careful about what you put in front of your mind. You know, as had some students when they first started with me that they were young and they were caught up in lustful thoughts and magazines like that. So you're just causing yourself headaches. Don't do that. Be careful what you put in front of your mind. Be careful of the kind of movies you watch. had this one lady that she came to me and she was really suffering. And she said, I keep on having these nightmares. And I said, well, why do you think that is? She said, I don't know. But it seems like every time I go to the movies, that night I have nightmares. And what kind of movies do you go see? Oh, I love horror movies. I love to scare myself. And I said, okay, don't do that anymore. Don't go to those movies. But I like it. Okay, fine. Don't come to me about your nightmare. You're doing it to yourself. What are you putting in front of your mind? What kind of things do you hold with your mind? Is it wholesome or is it unwholesome? How is your mind every time you have repeat thoughts? What are you doing with your mind? You have repeat thoughts because there's an attachment in there. Okay? I tell people that actually they should, there's a solution for televisions. It's called a brick. A brick. Don't watch the news. What kind of nonsense do you put in your mind? And newspapers. What kind of nonsense do you read about? There was one newspaper in all my time that I was in Asia for 12 years. There was only one newspaper that once a week printed good news. All the rest of the stuff was nonsense. Just stuff that makes you have an opinion about this or that. You read about, oh, that's happening in the world, and that's so terrible. Well, can you believe it? That's just one person's idea of what they think the world is like. Sometimes they get it close, sometimes they don't. What does that do to your mind? There was a woman came and did a retreat with me. And she only had gray, black, brown, white clothing. And I asked her, don't you have any colors? Don't you have some yellows and greens and blues and things like that? No. Do you read the newspaper every day? Oh yeah, I read 5 newspapers a day. 5 newspapers a day. So I told her, do you want to let go of this depression that you're in all the time? Well, yeah, okay. No more newspapers, no more television. And you have to go out and buy clothes that have color. You'd be surprised at how important that is. The more you have nice colors, the more it picks up your mind. It makes you more feel more happy. It really does work that way. And I have noticed that the favorite colors of people in England kind of match the sky. And everybody is so happy because when we came here, all of a sudden the sun came out. Oh, this is really good weather. I love this. You know, I was in Burma. I went to Burma 1990. And I was there for 2 years. Now, I didn't know anything about the news. All I did was meditate for 2 years. That's all I did. I got up and, well, at first I got up around 3 and I would go to bed around 10 or 11. And that changed after a while. But I didn't know anything that was happening on the outside world because I didn't talk to anybody. After 2 years, I said, okay, I'm going to go do something else. So I left and I found out that one of the biggest things of the century happened and I didn't know anything about it. Russia fell and I didn't know about it. I love history. And I missed this historical event. And I was kind of depressed by that. And then I started thinking, well, has that changed anything for me? Everything's still pretty much the same. I still eat the same kinds of food and go to the places I want to go to. No problem. So I decided, well, it really doesn't matter whether this kind of stuff happens or not. You eventually will hear about it if it's big enough, but you don't have to know about it every day. And you don't have to read this negative nonsense that this group is fighting with that group and we're gonna overcome this group and we're gonna have a lot of anger and dissatisfaction and dislike. Well, what kind of stuff are you putting in your mind? Does that lead to your happiness and well-being? Or does that lead to depression and sadness and anger and anxiety? Be careful what you put in front of your face. That's what harmonious lifestyle is all about. So, the next fold of the Eightfold Path, they call it right effort. And I call it harmonious practice. What does that mean?
6 hours.
That's right. 6 hours. It's the harmonious practice. And you'd be surprised at how many people that claim to be Buddhist don't actually practice right effort. I mean, it's shocking. Goenka and Mahasi Sayadaw both. They would have you stay and note or keep your attention on something until it changed, and then you could come back to your object of meditation. That's not right effort. Right effort is 4 parts, and it's real plain. You notice when an unwholesome thing arises. What's unwholesome? Any kind of hindrance, any kind of distraction. Why is it unwholesome? Because it's me, it's mine, it's who I am. It's a wrong belief in a personal self. Then you're supposed to release it. Let it go. Don't keep your attention on it. Goenka, you got a pain? What do? Put your attention in the middle of that guy. Let it be there as hard as, and stay with it as long as it's painful. Well, it just makes it more painful. it makes it much more difficult to endure. And that's not right effort. The Buddha didn't say that. He said, let go of the unwholesome. So I say, let go of the unwholesome and relax, because that completely lets go of the unwholesome. Now it says, bring up something wholesome. Smile. Bring that smiling, wholesome mind back to your object of meditation. And the last part is, stay with your object of meditation as long as you can. That's right effort. That's harmonious practice. And that's the difference between what a lot of you have been practicing for years. That's the difference between what you did before this and what you're doing now. And you notice that your progress seems to be a little bit faster than you ever had before. Imagine that. Well, that's just in agreement with the Buddha and right effort. He didn't want you to, well, it's going to take you 5 years to figure this one out. He didn't want that. You know, there was a lot of Hindu scholars and very sincere people that came to him and asked him really deep questions. And he would give them the simple answer. And they would just sit back and go, that's too easy. That's too simple. This practice is simple. It really is. It's not complicated. Just use the 6 R's. Right? When you follow that instruction, keep it simple. They call it KISS sometimes in America. Keep it simple. And then they say, stupid, but I don't say that. I say, keep it simple, son, or sister. Keep it simple, keep it easy. Don't complicate things. And your progress is going to be great. You know, When I first started teaching this way, I got really just so amazed, because I started reading the suttas to the students, and I was used to the Mahasi Sayadaw style, where it takes a few years to figure out how to do it and what you got to do before you really start progressing. And I started giving the retreats, and I started reading the suttas, and in 2 days I see people getting into jhana, and in 4 days I see people getting into the fourth jhana. It blew my mind. Now, it happened that way for me, but I was supposedly an advanced meditator. These were new people. They're progressing faster than I was. Wow. See, about 75% of the people that I teach actually get into the Arupa Jhanas. They get into all of these different Brahma Viharas. It's one of the reasons I teach the Brahma Viharas. Because your progress is faster with loving kindness and the Brahma Viharas than it is with any other kind of meditation that you can do. the Buddha, according to the Visuddhimagga, taught 40 different kinds of meditation. No, that's not right. He taught one kind of meditation. He taught 40 different kinds of objects of meditation. Some of them took longer than others. You do mindfulness of breathing. It takes about 6 weeks to get where you are right now. Whatever, you're in day number 8 or 9. It takes about 6 weeks to do that with mindfulness of breathing. But with loving kindness, you're carrying this with you all the time. You don't carry mindfulness of breathing with you all the time. You don't pay attention to your breath so much. Or if you have somebody says something and it gets you going a little bit, you have to say, wait, I have to watch my breath. Okay, now I have a calm mind. No, you can start radiating loving kindness right away, and forgiveness, and then that keeps your mind in balance. So practicing this kind of meditation has so many more advantages than the other kinds of meditation that the Buddha taught. And it's not that the other kinds are wrong. They're just different. You have to practice in a little different way. So, the next fold of the Eightfold Path, they call it right mindfulness. I call it harmonious observation. And observing how mind's attention moves from one thing to another. When you start observing that more and more clearly, you start seeing how the links of dependent origination actually work. You start seeing it on your own because you're observing how this process works. And it gets real interesting. I've been a monk for 33 years. When I became a monk, I was going to be a monk for 1 year. Yeah, I can get in and get to the first step, become a sotapanna, have 4 or 5 jhanas. I can do that in a year. Well, it didn't quite work out that way. But it got so interesting. I used to read books like this. It would take me 2 days, 3 days. That's all I would do, would just be read books. And that was, at the time, most of the books that I was reading was I was in Thailand. And they didn't have a whole lot of books in English. And I have dyslexia, so I'm not real good with languages. But I found where Kantipalo, he was an English monk, and he went to Australia. But I found his library, and his library was great. I mean, he had a lot of really good stuff. Finding this path and practicing this way and seeing the advantages that so many people had, I started looking at the suttas in a little different way. And I started going through the suttas to see how many times is the Brahma Viharas and the this mentioned a lot more times in mindfulness of breathing. Mindfulness of breathing 8 times in all the suttas. Loving kindness, well over 100. So what do you think he taught more? Right? There's a lot of suttas that are popular among people that it's only half the sutta. It doesn't show you the whole sutta quite often, like the Kalama Sutta, where the Buddha says, don't do this and don't believe this just because it's tradition and all of that. Well, it only goes halfway. The last half that he taught the Kalamas was Brahma Viharas. And that's real important to start understanding. So many people are attached to the breath. Well, that's what the Buddha did. Well, yeah, he did. But that's not what he taught most of the time. And he was helping people have lighter minds, happier minds. That's one of the reasons that in the Dhammapada it says, we're the happy ones. Because he was teaching loving kindness so much. Now the last fold of the Eightfold Path, they call it right concentration. And to me, that is one of the most misunderstood words in the Buddhist vocabulary. Because people think concentration means focus real heavy. But when you look up in the old Pali English dictionary that Rice Davies wrote, there's quite a long thing about the word samadhi. And he said that the word samadhi was never used before the Buddha. And after the Buddha died, when the Hindus started coming in and taking on the robes, they didn't know what the Buddha taught. They liked the word samadhi, so they changed the definition of samadhi to go along with the Vedas. Sama, tranquil. B, wisdom. Call this TWIM. Tranquil, wisdom, insight, meditation. Isn't that something? So the Eightfold Path, every time you smile, you can be practicing the entire Eightfold Path. Every time you use the 6 arts, you can be practicing the Eightfold Path at that time. Every time you practice forgiveness, you can be practicing the Eightfold Path at that time. Too many times things are divided up. That's one of the problems with the Visuddhimagga. And you look up in the Visuddhimagga there, and it'll have a page of this is equanimity, and it'll give you 10 different kinds of equanimity. And then you look up the word faith, and it'll give you 9 different definitions of faith. And it just keeps on dividing things. And that's one of the things that really kind of bothered me with that book. Because it divided this kind of meditation and said, well, this doesn't lead to Nibbana, but you can get great concentration with it, but you have to add the other kind of meditation. You have to add the Vipassana. And that doesn't agree with what it says in the suttas. It says that these are yoked together. You can't have one without the other. But there's been some changes over the last 2,500 years or 2,600 years with definitions and way things are practiced. When Buddhism started going into China, they had their own practices. They had their own kinds of meditation. So they just started practicing in the way that the Chinese like to practice, at one point in kinds of concentration. And they put Buddhist ideas in with it, so it sounded like that was a Buddhist practice. It's really interesting when you look at a map. At one time, about 800 years ago, that's roughly when the Muslims came into India. If you look at the map, all these countries all around Tibet were Buddhist. And it went all the way into Greece. There was even a Buddhist monastery in Egypt, which I found very interesting. But there's all of these different kinds of Buddhism all around China and Korea and Japan and India, and it's all over. It goes into Afghanistan and Pakistan. And then the Muslims came in. Okay. The Chinese invented gunpowder. Muslims invented the gun. And because they had these guns, they weren't really very efficient. But a gun meant I could be over here, and if you have a sword or a spear, I can make you drop that without getting hurt. So that's how they came into India. And when that happened, all the Buddhists started leaving. And they all went into Tibet. But Tibet had their own Bon religion. And eventually, there were so many Buddhists that they started affecting the leaders, and they started saying, okay, let's have some Buddhism in with that. But they mixed it in with some of their Bon religion, so it gets real confusing. But that's what happens. Every time Buddhism goes from one country to another, it kind of incorporates into that religion or into that country, and you never know what's going to come out of it. It went into Vietnam. And Vietnam, they had a lot of Mahayana, and they had a lot of different kinds of suttas. They weren't quite the same as China. So their brand of Mahayana is a little bit different than the Korean brand. That's a little bit different than the Japanese brand. And it's definitely different from the Theravada. The Theravada, they went south. They went into Thailand and Burma and Sri Lanka. And they stayed in the south of India for a real long time. But everything over time changes. And when the Buddha, when he first died, all the monks got together and decided which were the suttas that were most important that the Buddha gave, and they started chanting them and memorizing all of that. And they started to get, they divided some of the different books, and they appointed Aniruddha, who was taking care of the Anguttara Nikaya. And Ananda was taking care of the middling saints, although Ananda was, he was the guy that anybody that wanted to know anything about Buddhism, they would come to him. But over the years, that started going south. Now, in Sri Lanka, where the tooth is, the Buddha's tooth, there's a sect of Theravada that are keeping all of the original texts as close as they can. And they're still writing on palm leaves and things like that. And I spent some time there, and I was teaching them more about the middling sayings than they knew. Because they were just reciting things. They weren't understanding what they were really doing. So, anyway, this was the Eightfold Path. The Eightfold Path, the Sama Samadhi, is always the definition of that is first jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana. That's as far as it goes. Now the quote arupa jhanas, the immaterial realms, they're different states, but they're all attached to the fourth jhana. The equanimity in the fourth jhana is really a special thing. And you have to have that equanimity in all of the pramaviharas. And it's different levels of equanimity, of course, but you still have to have a lot, pretty strong equanimity to be able to stay with the different realms of meditation. So it's a real interesting history. For the first about 400 years, all of the Buddhist suttas were memorized. It was all done by memorization. And this is by far the most accurate way to keep things alive. Because, let's say, I spent 4 or 5 years or 10 years memorizing everything in this book. Okay, and I memorize it and I go over it. And then I go to where there are a bunch of monks that have memorized the middling saying. And I go to them and I say, I want the recognition that I have memorized this book and I'm correct. And they would say, fine. And they say, start chanting. And if they made a mistake on one word, then they would stop them, and they would discuss what word was wrong and how it was wrong. And then they would say, okay, now you got to go back to the beginning of this sutta and start over again. So they were really good at memorizing, and they did correct any mistake that was made. And when I was in Burma, every 2 weeks we got together and we had the Parimokkha, which is the 227 rules of the monks, and it's always recited. And if whoever is reciting it makes a mistake, all the monks come up and say, "No, no, 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 you made a mistake here. This is the word you want to." So then you have to start over again. But they keep a lot of the Buddhist teachings alive through memorization in Burma. When I went there, I had the opportunity to meet the Mingun Sayadaw. In the 50s, he had spent something like 19 years memorizing all of the Buddhist teaching. And he took a test on it. Okay. You know how you go to college now and you gotta take a test that's 4 hours long and you come back and you go, "Oh man, that was really tough, 4 hours." Well, he took a test on what he knew 10 hours a day for 30 days in a row. And he was 90% correct. He was in the Guinness World Book of Records for the best retentive memory. I had a chance to hang out with him. It was really nice. I could ask him a question about anything and he had the answer. Great. I had to go through a translator, which made it a little bit more difficult. But he was the chief answerer at the Six Buddhist Council. Mahasi Sayadaw was the chief questioner, and every time he asked a question, the Mingun Sayadaw would recite the sutta that the answer was in. So that's how they kept it alive. And he got so many monks inspired that they started memorizing the entire sutta, all the suttas again, every book. And now I think it's 9 or 11, I don't remember the number, of people that have memorized all of this and taken tests on it, and they did really good. But the thing with the Burmese is they like to, they kind of compete with each other when it comes to memorization of things. So it took the Mingun Sayadaw 19 years to memorize all of this stuff and really have it down cold. And now, the last one that I heard of, it only took him 9 years. That's really impressive. And they still take the tests in the same way. I mean, I tell you, okay, this sutta is the Chula Vidala Sutta, and I'm going to start reading from section number 3. I'm going to read this paragraph, and then you continue. And you have to go through all the rest, and then you go to the next one, and the next one. It's really remarkable. And it's kind of interesting going by the monasteries that do this because the monks are out reciting continually. And they don't recite in a quiet voice. They recite at the top of their lungs. Right? Burmese are, that's how they teach their children too. They have their children reciting things out loud. So they get them used to that, and they're quite intelligent. They're very interesting to be around. I much prefer being around the Burmese and their scholarship than being in Sri Lanka or Thailand or Cambodia when they started changing back over from Pol Pot, what was his name?
Pol Pot.
Yeah. When he let go and he left the country, there was a series of about, 15 or 18 years that there wasn't any Buddhists that were allowed in the country. So they were real enthusiastic to have Buddhists come back into Cambodia. And they asked me if I wanted to go and teach at the university, but I just couldn't see myself doing that, so I had to turn it down. But in Cambodia, they're starting to be much, much better scholarship now, and that's really nice. Anyway, with the Eightfold Path, there's a bunch more in this sutta that I think you'll find interesting. Lady, is that clinging the same as the five aggregates affected by clinging, or is the clinging something apart from the five aggregates affected by craving and clinging? Friend Visakha, that clinging is neither the same as the five aggregates affected by craving and clinging, nor is clinging something apart from the five aggregates affected by craving and clinging. It is the desire and lust in regard to the five aggregates affected by craving and clinging that is the clinging there. Lady, how does identity view come to be? Here, friend Visakha, an untaught, ordinary person who has no regard for noble ones and is unskilled and undisciplined in their Dhamma, who has no regard for true men and is unskilled and undisciplined in their Dhamma, regards material form as self, or self as possessed of material form, or material form as in self, or self as in material form. He regards feeling as self, or self as possessed of feeling, or feeling as in self, or self as in feeling. He regards perception as self, or self as possessed of perception, or perception as in self, or self as in perception. Now this is the identity view, and it always comes from I am that. It always comes from that craving that arises, and that's the first part of the identity view. He regards formations as self, or self as possessed of formations, or formations as in self, or self as in formations. He regards consciousness as self, or self as possessed of consciousness, or consciousness as in self, or self as in consciousness. That is how identity view comes to be. Lady, how does identity view not come to be? Friend Visakha, well-taught noble disciple, who has regard for noble ones and is skilled and disciplined in their Dhamma, who has regard for true men and is skilled and disciplined in their Dhamma. Does not regard material form as self, or self as possessed of material form, or material form as in self, or self as in material form. So you're not taking these different aggregates personally. That's what that's basically saying. Lady, what is the Noble Eightfold Path? Visakha, it is just this Noble Eightfold Path, that is, harmonious perspective, harmonious imaging, harmonious communication, harmonious movement, harmonious lifestyle, harmonious practice, harmonious observation, and harmonious collectiveness. Lady, is the Noble Eightfold Path conditioned or unconditioned? Friend Visakha, the Noble Eightfold Path is conditioned. Lady, are the three aggregates included by the Noble Eightfold Path, or is the Noble Eightfold Path included by the three aggregates? You'll see this in a minute. The three aggregates are not included by the Eightfold Path, friend Visakha, but the Eightfold Path is included by the three aggregates. And this is where the argument starts with the practicers and the scholars. Right speech, right action, right livelihood. These states are included in the aggregate of virtue. So we don't want to pay attention to those. Right effort, right mindfulness, right collectiveness. These states are included in the aggregate of collectiveness. Right view and right imaging. These states are included in the aggregate of wisdom. Lady, what is collectiveness? What is the basis of collectiveness? What is the equipment of collectiveness? What is the development of collectiveness? Good questions. Unification of mind, friend Visakha, is collectiveness. Coming together of and staying with your object. The four foundations of mindfulness are the basis for collectiveness. The four kinds of right effort are the equipment of collectiveness. That's the harmonious practice. The repetition, development, and cultivation of these same states is the development of collectiveness. You have a lot of repetition while you're doing the practice of meditation. How many times do you use the six R's? How many times do you see this is a hindrance and now I know what to do with it? So there's a lot of repetition that you wind up doing. And as you go to have more repetition, you're able to recognize more quickly, more easily, how these hindrances actually start and how to let them go. Lady, how many formations are there? There are these three formations. distance from Visakha. The bodily formation, the verbal formation, and the mental formation. But lady, what is the bodily formation? What is the verbal formation? What is the mental formation? In breathing and out breathing, friend, are the bodily formation. Thinking and examining thought are the verbal formation. Perception, feeling, and consciousness are the mental formation. But lady, why are in-breathing and out-breathing the bodily formation? Why are thinking and examining thought the verbal formation? Why are perception, feeling, and consciousness the mental formation? Friend Visakha, in-breathing and out-breathing are bodily. These are the states bound up with the body. That's why in-breathing and out-breathing are the bodily formation. First one thinks and then one examines and subsequently breaks out into speech. That is why thinking and examining thought are verbal formations. Perception, feeling, and consciousness are mental. These states are bound up with mind. That is why perception, feeling, and consciousness are mental formations. Lady, how does the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness come to be? Friend Visakha, when a person is attaining the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, it does not occur to him, I shall attain the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. Or, I am attaining the cessation of feeling, perception, and consciousness. Or, I have attained the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. But rather, his mind has previously been developed in such a way that it leads him to that state. Okay? So your mind is going to get to that state. And when it does, you don't know you're in that until you come out. No consciousness, right? So it's just a blank spot that happens. You don't notice a blank spot until you come out. And when you come out, there's such relief. It's like, wow, what was that? Okay? And depending on your mindfulness, if it's quite sharp, you can see little subtle tiny movements of mind's attention. Sometimes they say it's like dots, sometimes they say it's like dashes. It's described in a lot of different ways, but this is the links of dependent origination. And then they'll happen very fast, and then joy arises, strong, nice. You have attained Nibbana. And you know, it's kind of comical, because some people, I'll ask them what's happening with their meditation, and if they answer correctly, then I'll say something like, well, congratulations, you've attained Nibbana. And some of them will say, is that all it is? Oh, you've just given up an ocean of suffering, you know, that
all is done.
but they expected some kind of major fireworks.
Apparently.
Yeah. Is that all? I'm afraid so. You're never going to have doubt again. You're always going to know that if you do rites and rituals, you might like doing them, but you know it doesn't lead to Nibbana. And you're going to know more and more clearly the impersonal nature of everything. And as you continue on, you go through an experience like that again, that's the fruition, where everything becomes very solid. And you don't ever have any doubts as to whether this is the right path or not. You know that this is the right path. And you start to get more and more confidence in the Buddha's teaching, and you start to realize that the importance of keeping the precepts without breaking them really helps your whole situation in life. And there's great benefits of that. And the more you keep your precepts without breaking them, it turns into a protection for you. Now, there was a story about the Bodhisattva. He lived in a village where everybody kept their precepts. And then he got old enough and he went to a teacher, and they call it college these days, but he went to a teacher and to learn astronomy and astrology and all of these kind of things. And the teacher started talking to him, and where's your village, what do they do there, these kind of things. And the Bodhisattva said, in our village, people only die of natural death. They don't die of accidents. Oh, really? Why? Well, everybody keeps their precepts. So when you die, you're going to die a natural death. You're not going to die because you fell off a cliff, or somebody's going to come through and stab you, or whatever. You're going to die a natural death. And the teachers thought, I don't believe this. So he took a few days off and he went to the village, and he had some bones with him. And he went to the Bodhisattva's father and said, I have some bad news for you. Your son fell off a cliff and he died. And the father said, no, that's impossible. Can't happen. What do you mean? Well, he kept his precepts. He's not going to die that way. Doesn't happen. Impossible. So the teacher pulled out these bones and said, well, these are his bones. And the father said, no, they're not. It's impossible. He's not going to die that way. And finally the teacher had to fess up and say, well, yeah, you're right. I was just testing you to see whether it was true or not. You're not going to be walking across the street and get hit and killed by a car if you keep your precepts. I fell out of a tree 40 feet. As I was falling down, my mind said, relax. So I did. I relaxed all of my muscles. before I got to the ground where it would have killed me, I was going to land on my head, there was this two branches that were up, 6 feet, 7 feet, and it caught my leg. And I just folded down and I came down. I didn't even hit the ground. And the people, I was playing tree tag, and the people that I was playing it with, they were real worried, you know, that he's gonna kill himself. And the only thing I wound up with was a sore leg for about 3 or 4 days. Keep your precepts. It's important. So, you will start to truly appreciate your general mindfulness when you keep the precepts without breaking them. You'll know what you're going to say before you say it. You know what you're going to do before you do it. And that mindfulness helps you to decide to do the right thing at the right time. And I was with Lucille Ananda. We were in San Francisco, and we just got through walking across the street. There was somebody that was walking behind us that got hit by a car. So we stopped and turned around and started radiating loving kindness, doing all of this kind of thing. And Lucille Ananda said, you know, people that die a sudden death, like an accident like that, they're almost all reborn in a hell realm. Why? Because of the aversion and the pain that happens at the time of death. So, it is a kind of protection. That's why you do that. And it also makes your meditation better. You won't have so much distracting thoughts as you do this for longer and longer. I had a man in Malaysia came up to me, and he was Chinese. Chinese are very ambitious people. And he said, I want to get rich. Can you show me how to get rich? And I said, yes. Well, what do I have to do to get rich? I said, first you have to start practicing your generosity in all different ways. And you have to keep your precepts. And he's going, yeah, yeah. I've already heard all this stuff before. So finally he says, well, how long do I have to do that? And I said, well, we'll start it 100 years from now and go up from there. So don't mess around with this, just keep your precepts. You will be prosperous. Things come to you that are magical. Things happen for you that are magical. It's for real. When he first came to the center, he was taking care of the finances, and he came to me one day and he said, we only have enough money to last for another month. Then you're going to have to sell this place. I said, don't worry about it. It's okay. I didn't think about it after that, but the next day there was somebody that I had taught meditation to, and he sent me 10 gold coins. And at the time, each gold coin was worth about $1,700. So he sent $17,000 to it. Now he doesn't worry about finances anymore. When a person is attaining the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, it does not, oh, I've already gone through that, I'm sorry. Lady, when a person is attaining the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, which state ceases first in him? The bodily formation, the verbal formation, or the mental formation? Nisaka, when a monk is attaining the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, first the verbal formation ceases, then the bodily formation, then the mental formation. Lady, how does emergence from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness come to be? Friend Visakha, when a monk is emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, it does not occur to him, I shall emerge from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. Or I am emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. Or I have emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. But rather his mind has previously been developed in such a way that it leads him to that state. So it means that before you, when you're starting to test being able to go in and out of that state, you have to make a determination how long you're going to be in that state. When people first get to this and they start exploring a little bit, I have them sit for 10 minutes or 20 minutes and go in and out of that state, just so that they can see that they start getting confidence that they can do it. But also, you get unbelievable rest when you go in and out of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. One of my students is also she's running a large group in Indonesia, and she's a firecracker. She's always busy doing this and that. And she translates for me, and she sits in on all of the interviews that I give so that they don't understand what I'm saying, and that she can translate. Plus, taking care of all the needs that everybody has. And she's really tired. And she'll say, I'll be back in a half an hour. I'm going to go sit. And she'll sit for 15 minutes or 20 minutes and come back and be full of energy, full of vitality. It's really kind of fun to be around. Lady, when a person is emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, which states arise first in him? The bodily formation, verbal formation, or the mental formation? Friend Visakha, when a person is emerging from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, first the mental formation arises, then the bodily formation, then the verbal formation. Lady, when a person has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, how many kinds of contact touch him? Friend, when a monk has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, three kinds of contact touch him. The voidness contact, the signless contact, and the desireless contact. The voidness contact. It means there is contact with the body. The signless contact means that there's no, none of that. It means being in the complete cessation, but they still contact. And there is no desire at all in that person's mind. None. Lady, when a person has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, to what does his mind incline? To what does it lean? To what does it tend? Friend Visakha, when a person has emerged from the attainment of the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness, their mind inclines to seclusion, leans to seclusion, tends to seclusion. You just want to sit there. And once you have all of your senses back, you just want to sit quietly for a little while. Lady, how many kinds of feeling are there? Friend Visakha, there are three kinds of feeling. Pleasant feeling, painful feeling, and neither painful nor pleasant feeling. But lady, what is pleasant feeling? What is painful feeling? What is neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, whatever is felt bodily or mentally as pleasant and soothing is pleasant feeling. Whatever is felt bodily or mentally as painful and hurting is a painful feeling. Whatever is felt bodily or mentally as neither soothing nor hurting is neither painful nor pleasant feeling. Lady, what is pleasant feeling? What is painful feeling in regard to pleasant feeling? What is painful feeling and what is pleasant in regard to painful feeling? What is pleasant and what is painful in regard to neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, pleasant feeling is pleasant when it persists and painful when it changes. Painful feeling is painful when it persists and pleasant when it changes. Neither painful nor pleasant feeling is pleasant when there is knowledge of it, in other words, when your mindfulness is there, in other words, the equanimity. And painful when there's no knowledge of it. That means indifferent, and that tends, my mind tends to be
like bored or something.
More caught up in stuff without really noticing what it is. Lady, what underlying tendency underlies pleasant feeling? What underlying tendency underlies painful feeling? What underlying tendency underlies neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, the underlying tendency to lust underlies pleasant feeling. I like it, I want it. The underlying tendency to aversion underlies painful feeling. I don't like it, I don't want it. The underlying tendency to ignorance underlies a neither painful nor pleasant feeling, not paying attention. Lady, does the underlying tendency to lust underlie all pleasant feeling? Does the underlying tendency to aversion underlie all painful feeling? Does the underlying tendency to ignorance underlie all neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, the underlying tendency to lust does not underlie all pleasant feeling. The underlying tendency to aversion does not underlie all painful feeling. The underlying tendency to ignorance does not underlie all neither painful nor pleasant feeling. Lady, what should be abandoned in regard to pleasant feeling? What should be abandoned in regard to painful feeling? What should be abandoned in regard to neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, the underlying tendency to lust should be abandoned in regard to pleasant feeling. The underlying tendency to aversion should be abandoned in regard to painful feeling. The underlying tendency to ignorance should be abandoned in regard to neither painful nor pleasant feeling. Lady, does the underlying tendency to lust have to be abandoned in regard to all pleasant feeling? Does the underlying tendency to aversion have to be abandoned in regard to all painful feeling? Does the underlying tendency to ignorance have to be abandoned in regard to all neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, the underlying tendency to lust does not have to be abandoned in regard to all pleasant feeling. Why? Because there's no craving in it. In other words, getting into jhana. It's a pleasant feeling. But it doesn't have lust in it at that time. The underlying tendency to aversion does not have to be abandoned in regard to all painful feeling. The underlying tendency to ignorance does not have to be abandoned in regard to all neither painful nor pleasant. Here, friend Visakha, quite secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, a person enters upon and abides in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thinking, examining thought with joy and happiness born of seclusion. With that he abandons lust, and the underlying tendency to lust does not underlie that. Here a person considers thus, when shall I enter upon and abide in that base that the noble ones now enter upon and abide in? In other words, when am I going to attain Nibbana? I've been working for a long time. Why isn't it coming now? And one who thus generates a longing for the supreme liberation, grief arises, and with that longing as condition, with that he abandons aversion, but it's still painful because you don't get what you want. Or you start to get close to what you think is going to be Nibbana, and then you jump at it. Mm-hmm. Makes it go away immediately. So why do I tell you, before you sit, tell yourself, I don't care what happens next. My job is just to observe. With that kind of mind, you don't have longing in it. You don't have waiting. You don't have, bored. This stuff doesn't work. Well, it does work. It's not boring. But there's no mindfulness. So you have to let that kind of thing go. Here, with the abandoning of pleasure and pain, with the previous disappearance of joy and grief, a monk enters upon and abides in the fourth jhana, which has neither pain nor pleasure and purity of mindfulness due to equanimity. With that he abandons ignorance, and the underlying tendency to ignorance does not underlie that. Now you see the importance of the fourth jhana again. That's why I congratulated you when you got to the fourth jhana. It's important jhana because you understand more clearly how this process works once you get to the fourth jhana, because you have the direct experience of it. So this is the fun thing. Lady, what is the counterpart of pleasant feeling? Friend Visakha, painful feeling is the counterpart of pleasant feeling. What is the counterpart of painful feeling? Pleasant feeling is the counterpart of painful feeling. What is the counterpart of neither painful nor pleasant feeling? Ignorance is the counterpart of neither painful nor pleasant feeling. What is the counterpart of ignorance? True knowledge is the counterpart of ignorance. That means the opposite. What is the counterpart of true knowledge? Deliverance is the counterpart of true knowledge. What is the counterpart of deliverance? Nibbana is the counterpart of deliverance. Lady, what is the counterpart of Nibbana? Friend Visakha, you have pushed this line of questioning too far. You were not able to grasp the limit to the questions. For the holy life, friend, is grounded upon Nibbana, culminates in Nibbana, and ends in Nibbana. If you wish, friend Visakha, go to the Blessed One and ask him about the meaning of this. As the Blessed One explains it to you, you should remember it. Then the lay follower Visakha, having delighted and rejoiced in the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina's words, rose from the seat and after paying homage to him, keeping him on his right, he went to the Blessed One. After paying homage to him, sat down at one side and told the Blessed One his entire conversation with the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina. When he finished speaking, the Blessed One told him, "The Bhikkhuni Dhammadina is wise, Visakha. The Bhikkhuni Dhammadina has great wisdom. If you had asked me the meaning of this, I would have explained it to you in exactly the same way that the Bhikkhuni Dhammadina explained it. Such is its meaning, and you should remember it." That's what the Blessed One said. The lay follower Visakha was satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. But that's pretty high praise coming from the Buddha. That I, you asked me those same questions, I told you the same answers in the same way. And she, Dhammadina, is in other suttas, and she always has really good answers. It's real nice. So, do you have any other questions?
I have trouble understanding what it means that deliverance is the counterpart of Nirvana. What does that mean? Deliverance.
Having the attainment.
What's the good?
Deliverance is the attainment of Nirvana.
Oh, okay. Okay.
As to deliver.
Deliverance is the attainment of Nibbana. You become delivered. You become free from suffering. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, let's share some air.
Share this merit that we have thus acquired.